it is once again laying the bricks for the temple of commercialism, a very commercialism, a very glittering temple without any God in the sanctum sanctorum. We have a very costly temple which is empty of its God inside. Now, we want a science which is called the science of alignment. That is what the Tibetan calls education. What is alignment? Let us try to understand. We have in the physics laboratory of the boy a biconvex lens. Of course, this is only an example. You need not copy down the pictures. It's only by way of example. And there is a candle on the table and a screen. We are to make an experiment to catch the image of the flame on the screen. It is a simple experiment. And when the teacher, professor teaches us what the material of the candle contains, he cannot make us catch the image on the screen. Similarly, if he teaches about the formula of the glass technology and how the biconvex lens is prepared, he cannot make us catch the image on the screen. And two volumes are finished. One volume about the candle and another volume about the biconvex lens. And a third and a very big volume about what the screen is made up of. And a fourth volume about the addresses of the shops where these things are made available. But still the boy waits for the image of the candle on the screen. In the same way, we are waiting for the universities to give us a real image of ourselves in education. When we put together all the volumes produced by all the universities on this globe, we have thousands and thousands of volumes only about the candle, about the biconvex lens, and about the screen. But what is required is the adjustment of the three items, at least through a trial and error method. In case the professor does not know the distances at which he has to keep the three items. Because till today, no professor knows the distances at which the three items are to be placed. The three items are, the screen is the physical body, the biconvex lens is what we call the mind, and the flame of the candle is what we call I am. So we still wait for the alignment. So there are people who started experimenting for themselves. They stopped waiting for the universities and the governments to do it for them. And thus they started experimenting in their own homes. And they started this experiment thousands and thousands of years ago. And they are wonderfully successful in their experiments. They not only got the good results of their experiments, but also made use of the results and enjoyed the fruit of the results and recorded the results repeatedly to verify and find correct again and again the same results. And still they are continuing to do the same because they have no time to wait for the universities and the governments of the various nations. Because majority of the centuries, the universities and the governments are busy in constructing the new temple called commercialization of things. And those temples are left through centuries empty of the God in the temple. And they are there like the various different museums and centers of tourism. Just as we visit the pyramids in Egypt, and we visit the magnificent ancient buildings. So the universities are there only to visit and find something by way of tourism. And those who could find the alignment, those who know the calculations and the distances at which the three items are to be placed, those who can show you and teach you how to catch the image of the flame on the screen, they are the real educators of mankind through thousands of years. And they have no distinction of race, nation or century. And they are also not in the habit of deceiving the world by using literacy in the false name of education. Definitely the modern century is guilty of such a deception. And we have successfully deceived the following generations in giving them literacy and making them believe that it is education. It is time for us to understand that education has nothing to do with literacy. And what a citizen requires and what a boy requires is education irrespective of literacy. Because a man of education without any literacy at all is very useful to the society of humanity, because he is only positive and constructive in his way of doing things. Whereas a gentleman with full literacy and no real education is very sharp and intelligent enough to take the greatest commercial advantage upon mankind. So we believe that it is good to have literacy and education as well, but it is better to be an educated man if there is no possibility or chance of getting ourselves to become a literate. Educate your child first before you make him a literate. Don't allow the superstition to continue that you have to teach him alphabets and calculations in order to educate him first. Know how to deal with your child. Know how not to punish him, but how to make him understand himself. Make him behave better. Don't punish him to behave better. Show the benevolence required and be evolved enough to treat him as your own equal. See, don't be primitive to neglect the child by throwing him in an institute and not caring for him at all. It is worse than throwing a sheep into butchery. As a parent, you have the first duty to create your child. It's not enough to reproduce or procreate a child. To produce a child is a biological phenomenon which takes place automatically unless you control it. And the human being is not specially required to produce children, because dogs and pigs and cows do it automatically. So we cannot be proud of our children being produced. After producing, there is the process of creating them. That is, making them human beings. Teaching them the science of alignment. And galvanizing them with human values. This is the core of education, which someday the universities may take up as a subject. But since today the universities are primitive and Paleolithic enough not to recognize this, we do not wait for any universities or institutions. We remember that our children are more valuable than the institutions. And we remember that our time is valuable in creating our children after reproducing. And this is what we are taught by the real pioneers of education. Luckily, I belong to such a family that the members of my family in the previous generation believed in education more than literacy. And my father trained me in the science of man. And for a long time he never cared for any literacy at all. And when I was about 15 or 16, I began to pick up literacy and I became averagely normal within 3 or 4 years. Not that I am a great genius, but every average human being can pick up literacy within a maximum period of 3 or 4 years. And if at all, once one knows the method, one can know what is there in all the books printed till now within a maximum period of 10 years. So it is useless to spend our valuable life and span and time on literacy. First of all, make the machine fit and teach the child about the functions of the human machine. Let him have confidence in handling his own machine. That is what we call self-confidence, which is a very rare commodity in the educated world of the modern age. Everyone knows that he or she suffers from self-confidence, suffers from lack of self-confidence. The result is, everyone is afraid of others in the society, afraid of being deceived, or afraid of being insulted, or afraid of being ill-treated. And the inevitable result is competition instead of adjustment. If I grow without having a confidence on any one of you, I am bound to grow as a beast of competition. Because the spirit of competition proves the innate timidity the human being is having. The more self-confident you are, the more adjustment will be there in your expression. And immediately, you will begin to think of others before you think of yourself. Conversely, when you are innately timid, innately having a hollow of yourself, an empty barrel of your own I am in yourself, then you are there, dangerous to everyone around you. Because you are forced to believe that you cannot live without a spirit of competition. And by the time you realize that competition is the nature of a beast, not the human being, it will be too late to enjoy life. What's the use of our knowing that life is valuable and tasteful at the age of 80 or 90 or 100. When the spring season is gone, what's the use of our trying to enjoy in winter? That is the fate of the average human being at present in the 20th century. And even the so-called very highly educated fellow is afraid of all others. And he tries to know to become sharper and sharper against the society. And how to take more and more advantage against others. It is exactly at this point where we want real education. It is exactly at this point where we are very lucky that we have received real education from our parents and our family traditions. You too have your family traditions, but it is time that you should have more confidence about your family traditions than the other systems of education. But in this aspect, unfortunately, the West is the worst hit part of humanity. That is the result of the Industrial Revolution and the chain actions that followed. Human values are substituted by commercial values, so that the human being has everything at hand except the meaning of life. And he is not able to understand why he should live. When life is a succession of chasing and hunting busily the incidents of the daily routine, when the sum total and the substance of life is only fulfilling the daily items one after another, life is not enjoyable at all. Remember that life is for yourself, not for your routine. And life is for yourself, not for your job. And life is for yourself, not for the etiquette you have to show. And then you will begin to understand what real behavior is. Instead of being only polite in the society, you will begin to be affectionate. So substitute the values once again with the older values, the values of real human relationships. Believe that you are required by others. Don't believe that you require others for your livelihood. Believe that what you are doing is required by others. Believe that there is something valuable that the world expects from you. Then only you can believe that life is meaningful and valuable. And now we go into the modus operandi of this education. That is how to do it. In 1972, when I first came to the Occident for the first time, one gentleman asked me to see his father, who is very old. It was in Belgium. I said, I was glad to see an elderly gentleman, because I thought the old people in the Occident will be respected as much as the old people are respected in India. That was my fantastic idea about old people when I for the first time came here in 1972. But it was a big disappointment and a blow upon my heart. He took me in his car and he crossed long distances, and the city was over, he was taking somewhere. I asked him, is he not residing in your house? No, he said. I asked him, are you not residing with your father? He said, no. My father is residing in an old man's house. And he took me there. There were small rooms like cellars for animals, where the old animal was kept with everything he wanted to eat, to read and to sit and to stretch. He has shown me the animal and said, "This is my father." Because there was only that much relationship between the father and the son. Of course, as an Indian, I was shocked. Because till today we have no such experience with our old people. And the father was very happy to spend half an hour with me. And I saw something around his collar in the neck. There was something written upon the collar. I asked what it is. Then the son explained that it is the address and the telephone number of the son, so that it may be informed when the father is dead. What for? To honor the body, to conduct it to the mortuary, and to conduct the funeral function with much expense of money. Is it before death or after death that we have show our respect to father? Which alternative is meaningful and real? If after the death of the father, if we spend $50,000 on the corpse of my father, it is only my sentiment that is satisfied, but not the soul of the father. So it is foolish. Then while we were returning, the son asked me one question. He said, "It is a big problem about these old people in our countries." And then he immediately asked me, "India is a poor country. What are you doing with the old people there? How are you able to cope up with them?" See, there are many peculiar fellows who think in peculiar terms the countries like India and Africa. It is lack of communication between country and country that makes people think like that. He asked me, "Have you houses for old people run by the government?" "We do not have and we need not have them till today." And he asked me, "When the father is not earning, how can you feed him and meet his expenses?" Such questions never arise in our minds because we have our educational institutes at home before we send the children to school. The grandfather sits at home. The son goes and works in the office, and the grandfather is the friend, philosopher and guide of the grandson. Can't we understand this much, that the grandfather is a living temple who can radiate not only the information in the false name of education, who can radiate something which cannot be substituted? That is what we call experience, which no university is capable of giving us. And is not the grandfather capable of magnetizing his grandson by way of a scientific education, which we call induction? That is, not by way of infection. Now, the present day education is, we infect the students with the dirty ideas we have. Excuse me, but it is true, you cannot deny it. If Krishnamacharya has certain beliefs which are purely personal or political, which are detrimental to society, he infects the children of the parents who are sent to his school to teach them something against their own government and their own civic life. To teach them some dirty ideas about what he calls revolution, which is purely of a ghastly and negative nature. And the result is an undercurrent of a negative layer of generation that is going to explode in a global scale after the present generation becomes old. The result is a total sterility of the whole globe within a maximum period of 200 years. That is what we can call the method of infection in education. There is another method which we can call injection. That is the age-old method of torturing the child to reproduce the lessons. I prick the student and poke the student with the dirty contents of my injection tube. I want to push into the body of the student all the antibiotics which I have in the barrel of my tube. If the student is very good at reproducing every day punctually, like a merchant machine or calculator, I class him as a first-class student. That is too cruel and too primitive. And that is what I call the method of injection in education. And there is another method called brainwashing. By the time the student finishes his course in the college and university and comes home, he is already a foreigner to the members of his family. So, no institution like family exists almost today. But from the point of view of real education, the institution of a family is as valuable a temple as any other temple of spiritualism. In fact, the family is the temple of the masters of wisdom. And the concept of family allows you to live along with family members, even though you physically live away from them for 10 years or 15 years. What is it that makes a husband living in Geneva and a wife living in Paris understand that they are husband and wife? It is the pious temple which we call the family. It is the first institution which teaches you of what soul consciousness is. We have to know the alphabet of nature in terms of education. Nature has given us biological relationships of father, mother, child and brother. Only to use as the laboratories for affection development, to make the power of the heart expand and to find that something permeates between one member and the other, and that this something is more valuable and sweeter than anything in the world. And that it can be permeated between any two people in the world. So, in the first stage, the institution of family allows us to have biological relationships. And when we are trained in that institution by a master of affections, who is essentially a master in training in soul light and soul consciousness, then there is the next advanced step of practicing the same affection with a foreigner who is different from one of the members of his family. And that foreigner is whom we call the husband or wife. That is the marriage partner. Then we learn how to extend this soul light or affection to whom we call foreigners. That is the second step of education in the family. And the third is whom we call the guest. When we begin to honor the guests who come to our house, it is not the hospitality for social values and politeness. It is not for the good name that the hospitality of Mr. So-and-so is very good, but it is for the same taste which we call affection and soul consciousness.